That we're going to be covering OSX in depth. While this is booting up, we got some stuff to give away. Virus Barrier has a whole bunch of software here, and there's some books by O'Reilly, and that'll be given away more towards the end. Anyway, I started off doing macOS security stuff 3 years ago. I started Freaks Macintosh Archives shortly after the Weasels Archive went down. Started it only because all the Mac hacking sites were going offline and nobody could afford to keep them online, or they were violating terms of service from the free hosting providers. So I decided that I'd put it on, keep it up, and this is, since 1997, Freaks Macintosh Archives has been up. Along with Freaks Mac Archive, I started SecureMac.com. That was in 1999. Quaggy, you gotta stop. Thank you. That was in 1999. Macintosh security wasn't being noted by any of the news, any of the media. They thought it was a joke. The Macintosh news sites wouldn't even post anything on it because all the Mac people out there would start complaining and hating them, saying that they work for Microsoft. Mac people who read the Mac news sites are like really Mac people at heart, and they don't want to hear anything bad. So SecureMac.com was put up only to show a way that the public could accept it from a security administrator standpoint rather than a hacker standpoint. Both of those sites went offline for about a month because we lost hosting. It's back up now. We have another Macintosh security site, MacintoshSecurity.com, that will be up by the end of the week. That's more for Mac OS X, and it'll deal a lot integrating with all the other Macintosh security sites and hacking. So last year we briefly talked about Mac OS X. We weren't able to boot in it then either, but this year already, since the release of the public, there's been 4 noted security advisories put out by Apple. After we put together the Macintosh, after we put together the secure installation of OS X for SecureMac.com, Apple released their version of it. They have a security mailing list now, which they have neglected to put up in the past. They thought that it wasn't an issue. Those websites are going to be in the vendor area. There's a sheet of those with all the different Macintosh hacking and security. Most recently in the news, there's been a couple articles. News.com had OS X boosts Apple security concerns. Wired had Macs ripe for a hack. Both of these articles, from what I've heard, got a lot of negative response from the Mac people still, but it's being taken a little bit more seriously. Since OS X on Apple's site, they said it was pretty secure out of the box. We've already been shown that it's not secure all the way. A lot of it is based on the Unix environment, the BSD mock kernel. First off, with the sudo being able to gain administration privileges with it. The only reason why that was vulnerable is because they included a old version of sudo with Mac OS X. A new version was available, but somehow it got mixed up in there. That was fixed in OS 10.04. If you're still running 10.0, then there's patches available by Scott Anguish. He created custom installs. So those are available on that sheet also and on securemac.com. The other thing noted was the Macintosh Java runtime for Java, the ability to copy the person's clipboard running malicious code in Java applet. Apple fixed that. They've been rather responsive with everything that's happened. Unix people are used to etc password, where the password files are stored. Mac OS X, it's a little bit different, uses netinfo. Netinfo stores all the account information about the account and the passwords. There's been security concerns within that, dealing with programs like NIDump and the whole NI family being able to dump the password hash from that file, so you could easily crack it with a Unix password cracking app or the Mac OS classic one, Meltino. That issue hasn't been taken care of. There's been a lot of concerns as far as, is it really an issue? There's about 15 different ways to gain access to all the account information. NIDump is one of them, and the command for that one is NIDump password period, PASSWD period, and that'll dump the hash file for that. Another place it's stored is in /var/backup/local.nidump. There hasn't been a actual fix for it. People have talked about chmodding nidump, but you're dealing a lot with other programs that'll basically give you the same access. So you could chmod it 550 in /usr/bin/nidump, which I would show you if we had OSX up, but we don't. So perform the basic install for OSX. You're going to be pretty secure. There's four different things running. There's auto mount, syslog, sunrpc, and netinfo, which we talked about. Out of all those, the only one that there's been a concern with is netinfo. Auto mounter mounts network volume drives. You could see how that could become useful in the future when more hacks come available for it. So sudo prior to 1.637 is vulnerable, fixed in 10.0.4. Keeping your computer secure, root is disabled by default, so you're not going to have root password, anything like that. If you want to use root account, you have to use the administrator account to actually set it up. So that makes it a little bit more secure. Once you have the root password enabled, though, basically, root's enabled. Setting up firewall. IPFW, Mac OS X comes with built-in firewall functionality. A lot of people haven't been able to deal with it. Still using the command line for it from the Unix interface. So there's programs like Brickhouse out there, which offer a GUI to set up the firewall software. And it's fairly simple. The other thing running is FTP protocol, which you can modify using secure FTP. That software is available on glub.com. That is a secure FTP wrapper. It'll install the TCP wrapper on it and allow SSL connections using secure FTP client. SSH versus Telnet, you're going to want to stick with SSH. Telnet is done in plain text. Anything you send over it, of course, people can sniff. Setting up SSH, it's installed in 10.0.4. Prior to that, you have to get a build, and the URL for that is on the resource paper in the other room. Keeping it secure, like with any operating system, it offers the ability to have log files, and it uses the BSD log file system. Everything is stored in the logs directory under var. So if you keep an eye out for that, you will see when people try to connect your computer. You'll see any access that goes on. If you have somebody on your box that you don't trust, you could see if they're trying to like hack into your account from there. As far as security auditing tools for OSX, right now there aren't that many out there. People are porting the security software for it, but the vendors that are out there right now are facing different things because you're dealing with Unix and you're dealing with the Mac platform, so you can't truly port it over without losing the functionality of one part of the operating system. This software here, Virus Barrier, Net Barrier, that'll be available Q3. About viruses for OSX, currently there are not any, but there are virus scanners for it. There is there's the Virex command line scanner, and they also have the OSX GUI version of it. But right now, you're not going to run into anything like that. In the news, it's been the Simpsons virus, which was actually an Apple script that does almost the same ability that the Melissa virus did, emailing the addresses. So at least people have taken concern with it, and they're comparing it against other operating systems now, rather than just, it, you know, it's Mac OS, there's no hacks out for it, it's secure. Guest up here, his name is Agent OJ. He's from the Macintosh Underground programming group called Team 2600. He's here, he'll be talking a little bit about Team 2600's new program, and a little bit about the programming group and where to find them on the web.
Well, first off, I'd like to thank Freaky for giving me the time to speak here. A little bit of history about Team 2600. Team 2600 was founded in 1994 by Cybertosh and his friend Sixtime. Back then, they were still in high school, constantly arguing with their sysadmin over the battle between Windows and Macintosh. They were part of a 2600 news group online, and one day the topic came up about some Windows hacks, and they decided to put those to use on their school system and ended up hacking about 50 boxes there. And to show their admin up for his battling with them, they wrote, "You've been hacked by Team 2600, get secure, get a Mac," on the startup screen of every computer. After that, they decided that, hey, maybe they should start an actual Mac-only underground team, and that progressed from there. That was about 1996 that started, and their member base is slowly growing. Now we're at about 10 active members, and we are the largest underground Mac-only group that's active right now. We have about 10,000 web visitors a month to our site, which is www.team2600.com. We have a wide range of software, ranging from Portmaster, which is a port utility. We have some port scanners. There's Proxy Bouncer. It's a utility to stack proxies on it, and it enables proxy support and SOC support for any program that doesn't already have it. We also, what I've personally worked on is the Sub7 project for Macintosh. I ported over the client a few months ago, and the announcement today is that the server is almost finished for the Macintosh. Right now it's about 80% finished, and there is a preview copy available for anyone who is interested. That should be finishing up within the next couple months. Right now, I just have a couple things to demo on the screen that we finally got up. First off, I'll show our latest program, which is the Sub7 client port. And basically it's the normal Sub7 client, but just on Macintosh. It has all of the features: getting PC info, getting home info, getting passwords, everything that you'd want, the keyloggers up, and that will be ported generally to the Macintosh. Overall, We basically want to keep producing some quality programs. We're recently working on making more utilities for OS X. There's Yaba, which is a vulnerability scanner for OS X only and other Unix systems. It also runs on those. That's one of our newest programs. So we're always looking for new members or interested programmers. So check out our website and let us know if you'd be interested. Once again, I'd like to thank Freaky for giving me the time to speak here at DEF CON.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, back to OS X, single user mode. Command S during startup, that'll drop you into root mode where you can change the root password. The command for that is /sbin /mount -wu /that mounts the hard drive and read mode. Then you have to start up the system starter, /sbin /system starter. That starts the net info service that gives you the ability to change the root password. By typing root password without having to verify the original password, you can change the password on that, and then log out, log back in, you have root access. There's been a lot of people saying that that really isn't a vulnerability, that single user mode has existed in Unix operating systems as a way for them to get back in, just in case they break things. Mac OS people, they're bound to forget their passwords, a lot of them are. Get people asking me all the time, how do I get back into this? I forgot this password. So a way to protect that, there is a program out. It's on msec.net, made by a guy named Maruka. It's a patch that patches the system that disables single user mode. Now, by doing this, you're not going to be able to get back in. So if you forget your password, you're going to be screwed to some extent. Another way to disable it would be Apple's new ability, which is open firmware password protection. Open firmware offers you a way into the like back end of the operating system where it figures out how things are running. And you can enable the open firmware password protection. It's basically the same as BIOS password for PC. So when you try to get past it, it'll ask you for that password. To enable that command, you boot into it. And by doing command option PR, no, that'll zap the PRAM. OF, command option OF, thank you. That'll let you into the mode. From there, you could type in, let me get my notes up here. But by setting this, you're not going to be able to get back in it any other way. It's not supported by Apple, really. They don't have any documents on setting the password. So once that's set, you could be screwed if you forget your password. To enable that, it is so you type password, it will take you into there, password prompt. From there, you do set env, one word, security hyphen mode, space full, or you could do set n security hyphen mode, and then whatever command you want. To disable it, you log in to the same method, if you remember your password, and you do set n env security hyphen mode, and then you change it back to none. Zapping the PRAM by doing command option PR will not let you back in from it. You can boot from the CD by using the SCSI ID if you have a SCSI CD-ROM drive. That command is on my website. Right now, we're going to talk a little bit about, last year we talked about MacPork, which was the security analyst tool made by Darksider of Team 2600. It was a hit, but he didn't have the time to continue with it. So another group took on the project. It is called Mac Analyst now. It is a shareware application. It'll let you run it for 10 minutes. It is will scan any operating system you have. Their database is updated daily with new vulnerabilities. So from your Macintosh, you could do security auditing. You can see if your friends, your ISP's computers are secure. Some great things about the program, though, it gets kind of advanced within it. There's so many different options for it. We don't have a net connection here, though. From the menu, you see you have the standard TCP commands, just who is. And then you go down here to the security browser. You type in the URL. This is mostly for the CGI scripts that may rely on the system. If you do the standard scan, it'll tell you what you have running on it, and then you use this program right here to verify it. It'll execute the command for you, so you could actually see if it's just a port open that you have used for something else, or if it's actually vulnerable. From this list right here, you can see that there's quite a lot of different things that it checks for. The program is $50. There's many different things built in it. There's brute force, which will test the account with a password file. There we go again. With the password file, and see if it could gain access. This tool could be used by anybody. They market it for the security administration side, but if, let's say, a hacker got a hold of this, I mean, this could be their dream tool for the Mac OS. Has ICMP logger, you can see if people are pinging you, if you're one of those people who are on IRC and get attacked all the time. Supports plugins, it's updated all the time. It's done by a group of French people. So some of the spelling on here is incorrect, but they fix it right away. Okay, I have demo mode. So up here we have software. How many of you run Macs? Jesus, I remember last year there was about 10 people running Macs. How many of you are running OSX? Jesus. All right, well, the software I have up here isn't OSX. It's for classic OS9. First one is Virus Barrier. Now, if I throw this out and I hit somebody, are you gonna be pissed? All right, throw it out, man. This one right here, it was opened by customs when it was sent from France. Everything's in it. Thank you. Always entertaining. We'll get to more in a minute. But the Open Firmware Password Protection is a great advancement in Apple's operating system because they have not had anything like that in the past. All the security passwords for it, you've been able to bypass it by doing shift during startup, by bringing up the extension manager, by holding spacebar, disabling anything that you want to from there, or even by booting up off of a startup disk or CD. Open firmware password protection, when it's set, you won't be able to do all that, and you'll keep your computer more secure. It's excellent for environments where you have people rebooting your systems, trying to hack it all the time, school environments, because I remember when I went to school, the whole Mac classroom was full of people trying to get past the security programs they had on it. First, it was AtEase, which was very simple. This guy right here was in one of my classes, and we sat there just like hacking the network. It was pretty damn fun. All right, so you can play with Mac analysts, keep people entertained by that. Another group, O'Reilly, offered some stuff on Mac-related stuff. I got a t-shirt here for Coca. Programming language stuff that they got. They have a book out on it. They want you to buy it. So I got a t-shirt here. I'm gonna throw it out that way. Won't get far. Told you. Porting security-related applications. Thank you. Porting the security-related applications to OSX, as far as from the Unix platform, is going to be a lot simpler. It's going to take some people. It's going to take some people with Unix experience to understand it. A lot of people are used to the real basic programming language, rather than C or Perl or anything else that's now supported by OSX. So anybody who's into that, wanting to port some apps for it, it would be great to put on freaky.staticusers.net, my one-time plug of the day. There hasn't been that many new Macintosh security-related applications or hacking apps out for the past year. Team 2600 has been one of the major players in that. They've done a great job. Anything that you want done, you go to Packet Storm, you see a program there that you want ported to the Mac OS, you email this guy right here, and he'll have it taken care of. Sorry to put you in that situation. Programs for Mac OS Classic, new in the year. First one was done by Wido. He's been a Macintosh programmer. With the assistance of Deranged Cow. That program is called Mac Smurf. It lets you have the ability to send ICMP packets, basically an attacking program, Smurf attack, in fact, from the Mac OS. For years it hasn't been possible. Nobody's actually done it. Any application that's been out there hasn't been able to create the ICMP packets and forge it. Mac Smurf, it lets you do all of the above with it, use the broadcast address, everything. You're set with that program. What other OS 9 stuff we got on there? Oh, Jesus. No, I don't want that one. Etherpeg was a program demonstrated. It was actually created at the Mac Hack Conference. This program, I doubt it's configured for this computer, but the source code is included. You configure it for your Ethernet card. It'll sit and listen to the packets on the network. As any images go by, JPEGs, GIFs, it'll actually bring it up on your screen, and you'll see what they're doing. So whether they're, you know, looking at the nice sites or the dirty sites, you got them red-handed. So great tool for, you know, administrations or just people who want free porn. For OSX, enabling more security options on it, you have the ability to use GPG, which is the equivalent open source of PGP. It's GPG mail that has been ported to Mac OSX. There is a install client for it. So you could use your PGP ability under Mac OSX without paying the fees that network associates charges for it. Security scanning, Yabo was one of them that he mentioned. The other one is Snort. Is the program Snort. How many of you are familiar with it? Are you guys just screwing with me? Anyway, that has been ported to Mac OS X. It's a security intrusion type tool. So slowly and surely, we will see Mac OS X security applications available. As far as that, there really isn't that much security stuff for OS X. You have a little bit of scripts coming up, like that will make the box crash like that. C scripts, those are on freaky.staticusers.net, second time. And does anybody have any questions? please say no.
Is there a particular reason why I can't find IPFW anywhere?
IPFW? Is it not installed on your machine?
Is it not in the default install?
Try locate.
I did.
10.0.4? it is there because that's whether or not it's under a different name or where it's located. I don't know that right now. Probably under SBIN or something like that. But programs like the GUI applications for it use that. It interacts with that program to configure it. So it is on there. So we could find that for you. Okay, another t-shirt. This is the same one. Alright. Let's see what I could do. That's like the second out that way.
IPFW is under SBIN.
Yes, it's under SBIN. IPFW is under SBIN. Maybe your computer, somebody took it off because they didn't want you to set up a firewall. Yeah, try booting on the phone. Any other questions? Way in the back? That's you.
Looks like a lot of homeless companies are related to the mixture of old Mac OS and Unix style. I remember seeing the Apache one go by where it was a Mason sensitivity problem where it was looking for a certain thing. There's got to be a lot more than just running Apache on OSX. Has there been any evidence like that?
As far as that one goes, that's really the only Apache problem that's been noted right now. It's just simple things like that that end up becoming a problem. People upgrading from beta version to public version have noted that some of their directories are read world writable by everybody on there just because of some file permissions going on there. So if you upgrade, make sure that you look over all the file permissions, make sure that not everybody could access it, because, well, if you let anybody on your box, then you're basically a sitting duck.
At what level are things case sensitive? If I'm running Store on there and I've got a rule set for the case or unspecified case sensitive, does it get filtered before it gets to Snort?
I'm not sure about the case in Snort where sensitivity matters. We would demonstrate it right now. We're having a little bit of problem mirroring it. So if anybody, again, knows any information on that, there we go. All right, so first application that we're gonna demonstrate is Brickhouse, which does use IPFW to configure the firewall settings. There's a nice graphic user interface. Program first rolled out, it was free. Now there's like a $10 shareware on it. Simple programs, if you don't want to pay the shareware fee, there's other alternatives out there for it. All right, so let me have a seat here. What'd you do? Okay, another box. This one's net barrier. This is your basically firewall. It has a lot of other stuff in it. For instance, it could lock your modem, so it requires a password. So if you do have any Trojans or something like that that happens later on, it does lock your modem, so it won't be able to dial out. God, this is gonna rock. Yeah, next time I'll like surf it out there. That's all we have?
Yeah, just the background.
All right. You get to see the background for OSX. You don't get to see any of the applications for it, so we're still working on that.
Right now, yeah.
Yeah. Problems after problems. All right, more questions.
There we go.
You could, as far as all the development tools like GCC, you could get that off of Apple's website in their development center. They just took on, I believe it was a FreeBSD guy to do a lot of the porting for them or manage that team. So there will be a lot more applications quickly being ported for it. GCC is not installed by default.
No. Well, it is. No, it's
not. 10.0.4 it is. And it's on the developer CD, yes. All right, so we have it up on the screen here. This is Brickhouse. They took out a lot of the functionality in it because people were complaining they didn't understand what it was. When the program first rolled out, it was basically, it gave you, you could edit the log files for it, you could edit the actual settings for it. You still can now, but they have it worked into a nice GUI. Basically, filters on off, that simple. Once you close it, you save it, it's set up. Has ability for airport. How many of you are using airport? All right, the Etherpeg program also does support that. So if you're on an airport network or you're at a airport that supports the airport, you could be watching people's images as they go by. Setting it up is simple, it's self-explained. I feel like I'm wasting time here by just looking at it. Add gateway, edit gateway, restricted services. This must be demo mode.
Can you restrict port access?
Port access you can restrict. You can, there's the port mapping tools. Some of those are available for OSX now. You could restrict whether or not they allow the connections. Again, SSH, you could deal with the host allow deny files. Restricting or denying permission for specific services. You have all of the Unix functionality with a nice macOS interface. Sorry, you want to play with it?
Sure.
You can monitor everything that's going on with this. It's just like looking at the log file, except it brings up the log file for you in a nice, pretty background. Another thing that I've worked on over the past year was revising a chapter for this book, Maximum Security. Did the Macintosh Security chapter. Has a lot of new updates in it. Talks a little bit about OSX, but not because it was done so long ago. And a lot of the different hacking programs. This book is, in general, good book for anybody. So I'm going to give this away right now. Except this time I'm going to have my lovely assistant right here. Bring it to somebody. So basically you have to swoo her into giving it. Who wants it? Easy enough. I will have more of those books later on. I'll be giving them out. I got a few extra copies of it. Set up assistance for it. The program makes it so anybody could set up the firewall, whether or not you're a pro Unix user or you're just the good old Mac user. Brickhouse, like I said, is only one of them. If you go to securemac.com, you'll see other utilities there. SSH, is now supported in it. There's SSH administration utilities, SSHD administrator, which allows you to configure SSH, the accessibility of it, and everything like that. All right, who else had a question? That guy right there.
Hey, the open firmware path.
Yes. Once you have the open firmware password set in there, you do need to enter the password in it when you enter the open firmware password mode, or when you enter command. No, you won't be able to reset, zap the RAM, anything like that. So it is a way to keep you secure.
What kind of mail server is it running out of the box?
Mail server? None? Send mail? It's built in, but it's turned off by default. Many of the services are turned off because they wanted to make it out of the box secure, just like disabling root password.
Do you know much about if there would be security issues with SendMail as another reporting electronics?
So far as it stands, there hasn't been any noted security issues with SendMail for Mac OS X. I haven't compared anything to prior SendMail exploits or vulnerabilities like that. So we're standing clear until somebody goes out and hacks it again or finds a bug in it. SendMail is gonna be there. All right. This is the command file for it, the filter. This is the file that you could actually go into and set your own options in there, what you're going to allow, what you're not going to allow, the packet sizes that you're going to allow, things like that. All right, so Mac Analyst, they have given me the option of giving away 10 serial numbers for it, so at the end I'll collect your emails of that. First 10 people up here will get a free copy of it. Another thing, for the Mac, there hasn't really been any filtering software. One of the first ones out there, which works pretty well, is Content Barrier. You got kids, you got school, whatever. This program will keep log of everything going on. If somebody, you could set up your own filters in there, so if somebody says, how old are you, what's your age, what's your name, things like that. If you're a parent, you could have it send it to your cell phone, you could have it send you an email, so you can know when anything's going on like that. This program's going out right now. I was never that good at Frisbee. Which side haven't I hit? That side. Oh, shit! Jeff is never gonna let me back here again. Okay, nobody saw that, and is anybody gonna say anything?
No!
Because if somebody is, I mean, I could bribe them with this Apple script book right here. This time somebody could come up for it. All right, fine, you could have a t-shirt. Too bad. Here, this will get you started. A book on their Mac OS X stuff. All right, I'm gonna try to stay away from throwing shit. Any other questions?
Speaking of locking down services, do you know of any useful work to keep the net info binder from opening, from binding any ports while not crippling OS X?
His question was, is there any way to bind net info to specific ports without crippling OS X or the services?
From
To keep it from binding it. Anybody know the answer to that? I haven't. Oh, that guy back there. How do you know? That info is gone, the guy tells me. So what are they going to use to replace it?
Next week,
10.0.5. 10.1. See, we got an inside guy right here. Maybe we could have him come up here and tell us a little bit about inside OSX security. Yeah. Come on up! All right, another question? OSX and IPsec, what is going on with that? I want to look at that guy back there again.
Several private companies are developing solutions.
I am told several private companies are developing solutions for it. Solutions for it, so watch out for it. Yeah, it's not that hard. They just have to go and do it. Bringing in the free BSD guy, or the BSD guy. George? Ah, that guy. Yeah, he's gonna make it a lot easier for the macOS people to utilize all the functionality of it. All right, I'm gonna finish up here. Answer this guy's question over here. TCP wrappers, OSX does come with TCP wrappers in 10.0.4. Glove.com is so you could wrap the, it's a Java program, gives you the ability to wrap the FTP protocol. All right, everybody's leaving. Thank you very much.